Good afternoon, dear colleagues. My name is Valery Arkhipov. Me and my colleague Leonid Sinev represent AI machine learning at Sber Devices. Today, we'd like to talk about our experiments with the generative chat model, our learning experience, and our experience of using them as Sber products. So, first, what I'm going to tell you about. We'll start with the product vision and usage of our generative model in our new assistants recently presented. We'll talk about the top-level architecture and teaching the basic language model, the transition from a usual language model to a dialogue language model, all the tricks of pre-learning, and data set specifics. We'll also talk about the metrics of dialogue models. And as a bonus, we'll show you the funniest and most interesting generation examples. As you might already know, Sber have recently presented Salut's family of assistants. It's three characters: Sber, Afina, and Joy. And we decided to use different dialogue models for all of them. When I say chit-chat dialogue model, I mean all the systems that work in the mode, like, let's talk. When they don't need to get an answer to some practical questions, like turn on a movie or an audio or send money, when the user just needs a clever reply to something, a relevant reply, we use a classic retrieval dialogue model for Sber and Afina. But for Joy, we decided to use a generative model. Further, we'll tell you what the point of this model is, how it's better than the retrieval model, and how is it worse. First, though, to make you interested, I'd like to show you a few examples of how this model works. This was done during our testing. We created a Telegram bot to see how well this model can understand the context and generate answers. As you may see on the slide, there are some advantages and disadvantages. For the former, they're pretty good at understanding context. If a user starts talking about, for instance, music or poetry, and they continue that talk, like we usually do on social networks, this model is pretty good at supporting the conversation and generating sometimes even interesting replies, all within the context. As for the glaring disadvantages of these models, they're mostly connected to the imagination, so to say, of this model, especially concerning facts. It's very hard to get a correct answer from this model if you ask a direct question about some real physical phenomena or people. If you ask this model something like, what's the Great October Revolution? It's very likely to create something of its own. It will not be real, but it will still be pretty funny. You can see some of these examples in the slide. But anyway, let's go further. Here, I'd like to mention the metrics. You all know that machine learning and deep learning, analytics and metrics mean everything, because how we understand and evaluate the models impacts their further life cycles and our work. So when we're teaching language models, we of course check the perplexion metrics. Now, how about the dialogue model? Unfortunately, there are no automatic metrics for that, and it's almost impossible to make them really high quality. So here we have two key metrics. The first one is SSA, the one that Google presented when they worked on their chatbot Mina. It's what we do every day. Every experiment we make, has this kind of metrics.
Basically,
every reply of the bot gets a score in relevance and specificity. First of all, we check if the answer is actually relevant to the context. Also, we check how specific it is, saying, for instance, I don't know, it may be relevant to a whole lot of contexts. It's pretty logical, right? But it's absolutely not specific, and it's not something we want to see a lot. These two metrics are given by people, and then we average the results. It might be a good approach. This score is absolute. We can compare different generations of models, check the progress. But there's an alternative to this score system. We're working on it right now. We call it Acute Eval that Facebook has presented in their work. The difference is, it's much simpler, and the results are easier to interpret when we want to quickly check, for example, the difference of this experiment's results compared to another one when we have some change. We are going to discuss these two metrics and the Google app because it's more relevant for us at the moment.
Далее перейдем уже к, собственно, генеративной модели.
Now let's talk about the GPT model. The architectural platform here is GPT-2.
Ну, на самом деле здесь вот даже в скобках помечено, что и 3.
Well, actually, it's also 3. It's no secret that GPT-3 model is not exactly different from GPT-2. The main difference is the layers and the parameters number in the model. There's a great website from Jay Lemma that tells about the inner works of the model, about how the decoder layers work on the deepest level. And the difference between BERT and GPT-3 is that GPT-3 doesn't have an encoder layer. We don't encode or decode, we just decode. And thanks to that, we only see context on the left. We don't see context on the right. And we generate token by token. How you see that in the architecture model. What's interesting here is that GPT-2 itself is not a dialogue model. Even after we taught an English alternative to GPT-3 on Russian corpus, we'll talk about that later, we still needed some architectural changes in the model because the language model is taught to continue text. We give her a prompt and it continues that text until it hits a limit. Doesn't look like a dialogue, right? So we needed to change that. Having analyzed the situation in the market of dialogue architectures and model, we've decided to start experimenting with a modification proposed by our kind friends from Hugging Face company. I'm pretty sure many of you know it, for supporting and releasing great Transformers libraries. Thank you so much for that. They have participated in Convey AI competition some time ago, where teams competed for creating a model that would get a personality and try to give relevant responses to different queries. For example, if the description of the personality says it likes playing football and lives in New York, the model should use that in its responses, use the context. On this slide, you can see the architecture. It's very similar to classic GPT-2. The only difference is that the context vector here, actually there are three of them, the description of persona, the context of the dialogue, and finally the responses of the model that, you know, these responses of the model, they are combined with a number of destructors
подробнее расскажет.
My colleague will tell you about that later.
Подается в классический GPT.
And all of that is sent to classic GPT-2 transformer. Another difference is that it uses more than just language model functions.
Ну и
likelihood,
называемая NSP голова.
But also the NSP head.
Переводится как next sentence prediction, то есть здесь
MSP, a mixed sentence prediction, it's like an architectural trick for hidden layers. Our experiments showed that it increases the quality of dialogues. This architectural modification that happens before the teaching allows us to correct the model and make it a more of a dialogue model. And now I'd like to ask my colleague to tell you more about the transfer to the dialogue model. Hello! My turn now, after Valery. And I'll tell you about how we taught our dialogue model based on GPT-2. To teach all of that, we needed to look like real dialogues. So we needed to form a data set that would be stylistically close or similar to a human-human dialogue. It should have a wide set of topics covering different life questions. And it should be dedicated to the same topic inside one dialogue. It shouldn't stray away to something irrelevant. And we also need the responses to be interesting for both sides of the conversation. That's how we have two stages of the teaching. First of all, is teaching the GPT model based on the corpus of book data and news and cinema, around 180 gigabytes of Russian text. And we also have three orders of magnitude smaller data set from dialogues. You can see other parameters here on the slide. As for fine-tuning details, Valery mentioned one of them, which is using two heads of the model. Basically, one of them is a classic language model. Another one works on the classification of responses. If this response in this context correct or not. So we had a combined loss. Then we worked empirically to find some parameters of how to mix them, 2-2-1, where 2 points for the language model and 1 is for the multiple choice loss. Now, the number of candidates, wrong candidates, we tried between 2 and 7. We use that range and try to find the best one. Now, candidate's choice, we tried different options, and we switched from a simple random set of wrong answers that were wrong because they came from other dialogues. And we switched to a certain classification model of these wrong responses. We found the most incorrect answers for the certain dialogue. It was a separate, simpler neural network. To make it more realistic, we limited the steps in the dialogue by 128 tokens. So the basic classic 1024 tokens for GPT-2. We used a widely spread byte level BPE tokenizer. Now to generate for the generation, we used a nuclear sampling technique, where top P was found between 0.8 and 0.95. And the temperature was set between 0.8 and 1.2. This helped us work on each stage of the generation and select the most probable, statistically probable, of the statistics based on the text corpus. Another option was greedy generation. Just choose the maximum probabilities for the current token. The slide shows the two options. Greedy on the left, nucleus sampling on the right. Also, we've arrived at the conclusion that quality of the answers can be increased if we have several generated responses, and then we use a ranging technique. Can be another neural network, which is probabilities from another head, or just heuristics practically found. This all increases the quality of the work of this model. Moreover, we can also use another ranger that we used to select wrong candidates, just in the opposite way. And now, Valery, thank you so much, Leonid. Basically, we showed you the inner workings of how we experimented with this model, how we tried to improve it after we actually had it. The greedy versus nucleus sampling was an interesting slide. I have to add that greedy sampling can actually help us in some cases, especially when we talk about facts, but nucleus, as the results show, does increase the overall interest and the perception of such a dialogue model. To sum up, I would like to show you a few more examples of funny generation. Such examples show that, on the one hand, there are some good sides for such models. How do we put it? They always have something to say and can be at least funny. And it's really good at supporting a dialogue, and the person will continue talking to them. But if a person needs a serious conversation, and they don't need any imaginative answers, they need answers and facts, of course, this model needs work. We need some kind of post-processing on this model. We teach it not to swear, not to be offensive, etc., etc. You can see a few examples here. I'd like to add that one of the key components, non-surprisingly, for such models is a high-quality data set that we use for pre-learning. Each character needs a separate corpus with a personality for this chatbot, certain behavior, stylistics, and manner. If we didn't have that data set, teaching such a model on social network conversations or some others would be a really risky idea, because our experiments show that quality for such methods would really be affected by distortions, toxic replies, language specifics, the data sets, mean everything. That's all for my speech. We'll be happy to answer to your questions. Thank you.